¿Qué tal, Pedro? ¿Cómo estás?
Hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Qué tal, Diablo? ¿Cómo estás?
Hola,
Cine Internacional. Mucho gusto. ¿Qué tal? ¿Cómo estás?
Bueno.
Listo.
Hace 7 meses.
You left power 7 months ago, right?
8 months ago.
Y han pasado muchas cosas, no solamente en el mundo.
Several things have happened since you left the presidency, not only in the world, but in the region, and especially in Argentina. We can see that there are political forces against the spirit that you left when you finished your mandate on December the 10th.
My analysis is not only from the Argentine perspective. My scope is a little more wide. I analyze things from a regional perspective. What is happening in Argentina, what is happening in Brazil, what happened in the last election of Evo Morales in Bolivia. I think there's a throwback of what were national and populist governments in the region. There's an advance of what we can call the conservative right wing that restores social exclusion in terms of new realignments and abandoning the idea of regional unity that prevailed in the spirit of UNASUR, MERCOSUR, and CELAC since 1999, when it was the first government, when Hugo Chavez assumed the presidency of Venezuela. Then was Brazil with Lula, then Nestor Kirchner in Argentina, then the Frente Amplio in Uruguay, Lugo in Paraguay. All this is no accident. It is a regional movement that also had to do with a stage of neoliberalism, fundamentally in the 1990s, when it devastated and created a real social catastrophe in economic terms. Right? I think that was very clear. It also took place in a historical moment when the United States, right after 2001, due to the terrible impact of the 9/11 attacks, so the U.S. stopped observing as much and intervening in the region because obviously it had been attacked in its territory and there were other priorities. Nowadays, they still have other priorities, but I think they are starting to look again to the region that has always been seen as a reserve of food, water, minerals, almost seen as their own, right? In America. And also the emergence of these populist governments, nationals, Democrats. Because one of the characteristics is that, unlike what could have happened in the 20th century, there were also national and popular governments, but they were discussed in terms of methodology. No, no. These governments were characterized not only for the access to democracy, but also for a deep life in democracy and freedom of speech. Even when there were movements that attempted against the life of those governments and tried multiple times to be destabilizing, like the one I had to face in 2008 in Argentina, or the one currently experienced by Dilma Rousseff in Brazil. So, how do I see this? In Argentina, I see it as a very important setback because the achievements we gained were amazing, really. Beyond the heavy discourse, the numbers are objective. By December 10th last year, Argentina had reached the lowest level of foreign borrowing in foreign currency in its history, not just the last 10 or 20 years, of the past 200 years. We had never had this level of debt reduction, and the funny thing is that the government that achieved this debt reduction was the government that received the country with the world's largest default of sovereign debt. $100 billion of debt, 2 digits of unemployment, poverty at 54%, 46% of extreme poverty, and the Gini index was around 5%. There were free workers' commissions in the country, retirees receiving 200 pesos, and we end on December 9th with the lowest debt level in history, which allows the current government and the provincial governments to take debt. And I will reserve my forecast, because I don't have a good forecast for this kind of indebtedness. No tengo buen pronóstico de ese tipo de endeudamiento, pero bueno. Anyway, we also took the issue of workers. Argentine workers achieved wages with the highest purchasing power in the entire region, compared to dollars, not only in name, but in terms of quality of purchasing power, which is the way to measure wages. Not only in nominal terms, because I can have an average of $450 to $500 salary, but how many things can I acquire in my country with that amount? And we not only had the highest salary in dollars, but we also had the salary with greatest parity, purchasing power parity. So, with retirees, the same thing happened. The highest level of coverage. We practically had universal coverage of 97 to 98%. This happened because we also managed to recover the management of the retirement and pension fund. This also let us conduct inclusion programs. The retirement moratorium that caused so much anger among some because they said they had made no contributions, but they did not realize that we achieved greater consumption power, increased purchasing power of people to feed back into the country, in a world that, from the 2008 crisis, had become extremely difficult and complex. Because this whole phenomenon has occurred in a world with the 2008 crisis that has not yet been overcome, when the Lehman Brothers collapsed. I don't know after which bailout they went down, but they do have more bailouts than the pirates of the 18th century, and they are still rescuing banks while the people continue sinking. So, purchasing power, free workers' commissions, we never closed a workers' commission in Argentina during the 12 and a half years of government with a rate below inflation, ever. Wages always closed above the inflation rate. That's why there was purchasing power. As I said the other day at the Patria Institute, during a short speech I gave, during the 12 and a half years of our government, the trade unionists were the same, and now they are also the same. But now the workers' commission's negotiations that closed last year were half or less than inflation. It means that when joint negotiations closed above inflation with high purchasing power, it was not an achievement of the trade unionists. Por arriba de la inflación, con gran poder adquisitivo, no era. Beyond the exceptions that always are, by the way. But they were the result of a government policy that had conceived of wages of workers not as an economy price, but as a dynamic, an organizer effect of the economy through consumption. I know they will say, this is the stage of investment in consumption. No one invests without consumption. This is a very old argument among economists that comes from the era of classical economics. First the investment, then the consumption. And unless you discover the car like Henry Ford, or if it happens like what happened to Steve Jobs, that might be the first investment that generates demand, generates consumption. But when you produce food, when you produce cars, first it's the consumption that guarantees the employer that the investment will be profitable, because you will be able to place it on the domestic market or you'll be able to place it on the foreign market through exports. And today, in an absolutely outbid world with large surpluses, today the world has surpluses everywhere. All economies, regardless of their level of development, I mean from those with the highest technology and automation to those that produce commodities, have surplus in production because consumption has dropped worldwide. Consumption has dropped across the world because of the crisis that hasn't been solved. This is a product of increasingly greater inequality in income distribution that spreads like an oil slick across the globe. As a result, we have surplus production everywhere, as well as a trade policy of free imports. Today you can see in Argentine supermarkets oranges from anywhere in the world, fruit from anywhere in the world, food, pigs, etc. This doesn't mean you have to have a closed economy, but an economy that takes care of its producers, investors, and small and medium-sized industry. This was the situation in Argentina by December 9th. And you might say, well, that's an opinion. But I remember, and no, this is not my merit. I do not take it as my merit, but as a merit of the policies developed in the last 12 and a half years. A model, a national project. I do not remember, and please, if you remember, tell me, a government in Argentina that after being 12 and a half years in power, on its last day in office, said goodbye to its people with a crowded square like never before, and they were not organized by any political party. But what deeply excited me in the square that December 9th was the heterogeneity, all the social classes that were in the square. The first thing I noticed when I stepped off the helicopter next to the Casa Rosada was that in other mobilizations, which were many and very large, was the number of buses, the amount of buses that scare some politicians in Argentina because they say that people take them with political interests to demonstrate. I mean, not everyone has a car, and if you live far away and you want to attend a demonstration, you'll need to use a bus. The first thing that drew my attention in the square that December 9th, there were no buses. I stepped off the helicopter and there were no buses. On the contrary, there was a great amount of cars that were parked everywhere, on the sidewalk, at the little squares. Like people who just arrived and left their car. That's strange, there were no buses, only cars. And when I saw the square, there were no flags, no banners. There were a lot of people. Lots of people. And for what I know, they stayed there for a long time. You know why? Because they were people who were not used to attending public demonstrations. They attended the demonstration on their own. When public events are done, they're organized so that people enter one side and exit another, and they leave in the same order, so public demonstrations last 20 minutes, and in half an hour the square is empty. But some people spent 2 hours before they reached their cars, that they had left, let's say, at the obelisk, because people collided against each other because they didn't know what to do, because there were people from all ages, entire families. So I say, if after 12 and a half years, in an event that I dare call historical, a country, or at least an important part of this heterogeneous population, went to say goodbye to the outgoing government, surely there must have been errors. We must have made mistakes. There must have been bad things. However, we agreed that it is a phenomenon that had never been seen, and I hope that all governments from here on, when completed, could be saying goodbye with a square full of people. I do see setbacks, obviously, in freedom. I cannot fail to mention the case of Milagro Sala, a political prisoner. And now there are other political activists that have been imprisoned too, including other social leaders and her husband. The government has also paved the way to layoffs. Today, unemployment, together with insecurity and inflation, are among the main concerns of Argentines. Unemployment was not an issue during my tenure. Inflation was a subject constantly used by the hegemonic media. I remember features that lasted an hour about the value of tomatoes, for example. It appears that the price of tomatoes was so high and everyone was already almost unable to buy tomatoes. Today, inflation and price variation of food is constant. Inflation that, I believe, must be exceeding 50% beyond the measurements. Measurements were always very criticized during our administration. We went 6-7 months without any measurement. And interestingly, those who could not measure from the INDEC, the National Institute of Statistics and Censuses, with 700, 800, 1,000 employees and all the instruments of a body of this nature, were those who told us during my administration every month how inflation was. The current head of INDEC is one who hung out with people in Congress and one who was always talking about inflation. And they were consultants who had two employees or none. And then with INDEC on their side and all the provincial statistics offices as well, because you know there are agreements between INDEC and each one of the provincial government statistics offices where employment rates are supplied. Unemployment is measured provincially, then they communicate these developments to INDEC. They were able to order Congress to almost line up and take distance so they would vote on an agreement with the vulture funds that I think was very bad. And, well, they thought it was going to rain down dollars from this agreement with the vultures. And no, investments are governed by other issues. Although we suffered a fierce attack globally, financially, because today I say there are three fundamental legs around this new process that the world lives and particularly the region. A media leg, a judicial leg, and on the other hand, the financial sector. That spreads like an oil stain on the world and marks these two sectors. And, well, we face an attack through our management for not wanting to pay the 1,600% in dollars, which seems to me to exceed any usurious concept of high interest and enter into dispossession. One thing is usury, unreasonably high interest rates, and another is direct dispossession. And I think the fact that there was a split between the parties that could access the government was precisely what encouraged the vulture funds to continue demanding, because there were people who told them, behind the government's back, that if they got into power, they would arrange it with them so that they could be paid anything. This obviously gave unusual strength to the vulture funds so that they could stand strong and say no, it was this or nothing. I wonder what would have been the solution for Argentines if all political parties who had always talked about national unity and reaching a great agreement could have reached a big agreement among everyone to say whoever wins, this is what we'll pay. I'm absolutely convinced that if this had been the attitude of all political forces that don't necessarily need to have a progressive or leftist view, but to simply love their country and see the external debt as one of the main problem that our country and the region went through for decades. And today it's also a terrible problem in Greece and elsewhere in the world. In Spain, today it spends already almost 100% of its GDP on debt. And I was reading in press reports that I get every day that last year, in 2015, 36,000 families lost their homes to foreclosures in Spain. The government has hardly been able to form a government, now PP with Ciudadanos, but with a meager 30-odd percent, 40 percent, and with an economy in meltdown. Let's agree that it's a complex moment for the country, in a complex moment in the world. We Argentines are always talking as if the planet is Argentina, as if we were isolated from the world and it had nothing to do with us. Well, I think all of this has an influence. The Brexit, UK leaving the European Union, the global situation, the disintegration of regional bodies as well. Mercosur is very weak, UNASUR as well. We see that the European Union is also weakened. The UK leaving was a strong blow to the European Union. The BRICS alliance was presented as an alternative. I still have memories of President Dilma Rousseff in Brasilia summoning UNASUR and BRICS. I remember when this group was formed, the special fund of BRICS, which would have been a sort of alternative fund. Well, there were difficulties. Obviously, there were difficulties in Brazil, which we know about. Russia also had difficulties in its economy. With this, we can see that in terms of economy and economic blocks that seem to emerge from a growing multipolarity of the world, the situation in the region of Mercosur, the situation of the BRICS themselves, the situation of the weakening of the EU, of the European Union from the objective fact of the separation of England, reveals that it seemed that such multipolarity that was increasingly growing had suffered an impairment, and there's a tendency again, not toward a unipolar world, but something that looks a lot like it. And that's not good for anyone, not even for those who appear as beneficiaries of this apparent resurgence of unipolarity, right? So it's a difficult time. As I was saying, the government had an assessment. I think it was wrong. They thought that dollars were going to rain down. I also think that on April 13th, no one talked about gas and electricity tariffs. And I remember saying when the pact was completed, the talk of a citizen front, where there would be a reconstruction of new majorities, no longer on the basis of how they were ordered in parties, but on how they were going to be attacked or not by the economic policy. And I talked about the electricity and gas bills and the supermarket bill on April 13th, when there was no political leader in Argentina to record this. They were all excited because they had approved the deal with the vulture funds and everything was going to be solved. And this doesn't make me some kind of visionary, clairvoyant, or smart, but simply a person who had been sitting 8 years on the chair of the Casa Rosada and who was not just a person wasting time sitting in that chair. And I knew that these increases, that nobody had paid enough attention to, announced in late January and late February, that when they arrived, they would have a phenomenal impact on inflation, on the quality of life, and all economic activity. Because there was this idea that the subsidies were for morochos, that the subsidies were for poor people, for village people, for black people, for whatever you want to call them, for heads, as they were contemptuously called before. And no, subsidies were for the whole economy. They were for small and medium-sized industries, and also for larger ones. Subsidies were indirect wages for workers, for the middle class that could consume, that could travel, that could buy a car or exchange, or buy a house. And this, I think, was not properly displayed. And I remember that the Minister of Economy said that the increase was the same as the worth of two pizzas. This is recorded. I don't usually make assessments based in subjectivities. But on objective facts. And I remember that when a journalist, colleague of yours, asked about the impact of rising rates in the economy, the Minister of Economy, who is supposed to have an evaluation of what will happen, said it was the price of two pizzas.
El ministro de Economía, que se supone que tiene una evaluación de qué va a pasar, dijo que era el precio de dos pizzas.
It was done in this way. Well, it was more than two pizzas. Not even one of the most expensive pizzas with red peppers, ham, and olives of all kinds is enough to pay a bill. So I think there was also a bad assessment. I think there was also a bad evaluation to eliminate state income that weighed on the most concentrated sectors of the economy that had high profitability, and a deficit was drawn that didn't exist. Because INDEC itself had reported that the deficit was 1.9 and not the 7 creative points the Minister of Economy said. And it was also inconsistent. If there was a deficit, to cut precisely sectors such as mining, withholding or highly concentrated sectors of primary production. Also the famous export rights. One always thinks the first thing to do is fiscally balance the country, if you think the problem is fiscal. But to say that there is a 7-point deficit, to reduce the higher income sector, export rights or taxes, or if you want to import cars, on the other hand, to put rates that were 1,000-odd% that impact the whole economy from the informal sectors to the high businesses, it's like a cocktail that altogether doesn't close. Because one is contradictory with the other. So I think there was a bad evaluation. I think there was a miscalculation or lack of calculation. Or maybe what they wanted was to provoke a shock to then have a support. So that the workers would accept any salary for fear of losing their salaries. That is a kind of flexible or precarious obligation by the fear of losing a salary or because money was not enough. Was it to cause a shock? Well, that's a field of hypothesis that I don't like to address. But the truth is that beyond the assumptions or intentions, that no one doubts the good intentions of anyone, it seems to me that the result has not been what's expected. It's no longer the one expected by society, which had been told that there weren't going to be any rate hikes, that there would be no devaluation, that no one was going to be chased, that there would be no layoffs, that everything would be better, even football was going to be kept, football for all. I'm not talking about that, but simply that the results were not even expected by the team that called themselves the best team in the last 50 years. A great intellectual, great intellectual. I don't know if the best, let me defend Belgrano, who's my favorite, but a great intellectual.
Estuve reparando en que en estas últimas semanas viví a diferencia de lo que fue mayo del 2010.
It was noticed that in recent weeks, unlike in May 2010, that there was a very cold independence bicentennial, in contrast to the heat of May 2010. This comes up with something that worries me, and it has also been a motivation in many moments in your government and also during the years of Néstor Kirchner. In Mexico, where I've been living for the last several years, many of us have become aware of the systematic void of the national history of that country that was so important to us, and where Manuel Ugarte, being ambassador in the years 49 to 50, the man of the Patria Grande, was perhaps the best of all, and so I was grateful.
For me, history has always been very important, as significant, but not as a tale and a short story of what happened to us, but as an understanding, a significance of what is happening to us and what can happen. Because history is not a story about who was, how they crossed the Andes, if Mariquita Sánchez de Thompson sang the national anthem at the tune of a piano with a runner or not. The story has to, at least for those who are in the militancy and make politics an instrument with which you can change the destiny of a country and the destiny of a people.
Por lo menos para quienes militamos y hacemos de la política el instrumento con el cual se puede cambiar.
History is the way we interpret what happened, understand what happened, understand what is happening to us, to anticipate what may come.
Lo que pasó, entender lo que nos está pasando y poder prever lo que puede venir.
But also, it's a way of knowing why we are going through these things. And one of the questions I always had as central, and that's why the commemoration of May 25th for me was very important, for Argentines, because May 25th, 1810, was owned by the liberal historiography in Argentina. Even Perón had taken July 9th as economic independence, etc., because suddenly on May 25th was the Mayo Caseros line. It was the line of those who had come after Caseros, non-nationalists. And it seemed to me, because of May 25th, I don't know if I will be a product of the Bellican generation. On May 25th, we represented it at school. Boys painted mustaches on themselves. It was popular culture. And suddenly I thought to myself, popular culture?
Y a mí me parecía que no. Porque el 25 de mayo, no sé si
And the first centennial was held under siege, with strong repression. The Spanish Infanta, who had come to visit us, and this magnificent elevator at the Casa Rosada for the president was a gift to mark the centenary of the Infanta, who paraded herself in her chariot through the streets of Buenos Aires.
Y el primer centenario había sido celebrado bajo estado de sitio, con fuerte represión,
in a state of siege, with repression, hunger, and unemployment, with workers in prison, etc. And being a senator, I started to be interested in the bicentennial, and when Néstor won the presidency, well, we started working with an architect, Margarita Gutman, who visited me, and she was from the New American School of New York, the University of Stiglitz. We began to discuss the bicentennial, how it had to be.
Y a mí me empezó, ya siendo senadora,
I'm talking about 2004, 2005. We did not know who would be president in 2010, and I started there to talk about the bicentennial and to think that it had to be first national. Profoundly national, that it had to be federal, had to be popular, and it had to be South American, regional, from Latin American integration, because it was history, in addition to May 25th. Who did San Martin liberate? In Chile, Peru, then he met Bolivar. I was not making up a story, as some say. No, it was not a story. Those who hid the story were others. I'll give an interpretation of that because I have an interpretation about what you're asking me. So when we say the story? What happened to us since that May 25th to May 25th, 2010? And the truth is that on May 25th, 2010, we walked among the people. Piñera, president of Chile, Lula, president of Brazil, Fernando Lugo from Paraguay, Evo Morales from Bolivia, Pepe Mujica from Uruguay, Rafael Correa from Ecuador.
Rafael Correa de Ecuador.
No cops.
Sin policías. Chávez.
Chávez. Oh God, Hugo. God, God. Hugo, yes. My dear friend Hugo. Hugo walking among the people.
Hugo. Caminando entre la gente.
There is a friend who always tells me, I was doing pogo, and suddenly I turn around. I bumped into someone, and it was Evo Morales, who was behind me. I could not believe it, and it was amazing. First, when the presidents went outside, looked at each other, looked at me, and said, are we going to walk like this, among people in the street? Relax, nothing will happen, I told them. Let's go. Nobody's going to do anything. The truth is, there aren't many records of nearly 10 presidents walking in a crowd that surpassed 3 million people. Pepe told me, imagine, on the streets here all Uruguay can fit together. And they were just another person in the crowd. It was a very emotional thing. And then, memory of our history, where besides that, I'll tell you a secret. We had prepared to first burst out with the La Patria Voladora, the flying homeland. Do you remember the flying homeland? And due to a problem, we could not get out of the flying homeland, and the flag of the Aboriginal people came out first. The first flag was not that of Argentina, but of the first native peoples. And luckily, it came out correctly in historical terms that the first parade will be led by the indigenous people, and only later came out the flying homeland flag with all the history. Then history has an important place, because I think the problems we have had here are the product of a cultural subordination. The military and political colonization, from which we were liberated by our founding fathers and the fathers of the country, was later replaced by a kind of cultural colonization which Peronism, Irigoyenism, Rosasism fought hard. But there were struggles with cyclical developments and also historical setbacks, because there was never a cultural consolidation of what these popular movements promoted. What Álvaro Linera said the other day when he spoke about the unclassing of the lower classes when they rise. When they're the product of the policies that make popular governments, they end up ascending socially and politically beyond the personal effort that obviously everyone has to progress. It's the result of government policies. And that one can work for a lifetime, as a friend of mine said, tell me, before Kirchner came to the government, did you sleep until noon? You didn't work? And why only since 2003, 2004, 2005, you could buy a house, a car? Before you didn't work, or study, or get up early? Yes, but it wasn't enough, because there wasn't a state to accompany you with public policies. This thing related to cultural subordination has to do with history. That is why history is so important. Not as an epic question or of trying to play the hero, but simply because it's important. That's why the world's powerful countries, and if you want, I can speak about the United States, make movies about their history. The Hollywood movie industry is a machine that teaches culture, and they tell it the way that they want, obviously. You look at the Second World War, and it seems as if the Yankees won it alone. And it turns out that when you look at the numbers, 400,000 U.S. soldiers died and 26 million Russians died, consisting of both soldiers and civilians. Many more Russian soldiers, I think 8 million Russian soldiers, died, and the rest were civilians. The Russians had the highest casualties in the Second World War. Regardless, you ask anyone in the world who won the war? The Yankees. Because they told the history, the North Americans. They constituted it. No one denies that. An important contribution. No one denies that either. That is why it is so important to teach history, and those who have best taught it are the same that today rule the world, which is the United States. So it's important to know who is teaching history and how it's being taught. It's not a question of a story and epic. It's also an issue of what is the balance of forces in the world. And to conclude, I do not want to answer your question. That anguish, I think you're referring to what the president said in front of the king, the retired king to be more correct, on July 9th. I'm going to be honest, for it would be easy and politically opportune to do a whole elucidation about colonialism. A colonized mind is this or that. My daughter thinks that being a colony can also be a political desire. I, if you allow me, have a very personal interpretation about this phrase. I think that someone who psychoanalyzes themselves for a long time, who was raised by a very well-off family, and by a very dominating father. I know that tomorrow I'm going to be strongly criticized for all of this. They are going to say, psychological interpretation, she involves family issues. No, I simply interject with an expression. I think that the moment the president reflected on the anguish, when he talked about the anguish of the founding fathers likely felt when they worked for independence, if you will allow me a psychological interpretation, I think he was reflecting on a personal sentiment about what someone can feel, someone who felt protected, covered, in an environment where they had become independent from a very strong paternal figure. There, my daughter has a point. Being a colony may be a political desire, but allow me this psychological interpretation, benevolent if you will. But the president isn't only someone who knows our history, nor would he celebrate such knowledge. Furthermore, I believe that in that interpretation and that phenomenon of anguish it refers to, anguish is not a political, patriotic, and historic sentiment. Anguish has to do with something more personal. When someone feels anguished, someone is worried about politics. They're worried about the economic situation. But anguish makes, at least, no one should ever psychoanalyze this anguish. For me, it refers more to a personal mood than a political historical interpretation. Above all, for a person who has not made politics and history their leitmotif.
Touching on the subject of the president and what you previously referred to as the judicial game, recently your lawyer said that he was considering turning to an international tribunal to denounce harassment and court prosecution for this wave of investigations, indictments, and criminal complaints. I wanted to ask if he will actually do it. What court would it be? And what do you think will happen with those cases?
¿Qué piensa que va a pasar con esas causas?
A ver.
Let's see. I think that the phenomenon that is being seen in Argentina isn't a phenomenon either. I go back to the beginning when Agardo asked me. We saw the judicial game today. I think in the world there's a judicial game, at least in certain regions. Very clear in the appearance of a media game that judges publicly. A judicial game that is like a mirror of that media game and, well, a sector that intervenes with these two fundamental tools. In the region, this can be seen very clearly. In the case of Brazil, this intervention of the judicial game can be seen very clearly. Here you can also see it, during all of our management, because this is not a question of something that comes now. Our management saw very strong intervention by the judicial game, the media law, that was a model against the monopolization or the hegemonic media, was suspended by this media game. We had, when we wanted to play with reserves, which we later finally achieved, precautionary measures. There was always intervention by the judicial game, the project, the intent that we made to democratize judicial power. The last corporatist power that was left in Argentina. And it consisted basically that not the judges, instead those were part of the magistrates' council, the judges that were part of the magistrates' council, the academics that were part of the magistrates' council, the lawyers that were part of the magistrates' council, would also be elected to a popular vote like the lawmakers and senators that make up the organism. Not the judges who judge, because evidently that would be not convenient. Well, it was the only time that the court used their per saltum power. Also, there were laws that they broke a little bit with that interference of judicial power, where there were children of the judge, the family that constitute what is known as a judicial family. It was an attempt and a very broad democratization project that allowed for democracy to enter a power that is naturally corporatist. Because the fact that power for life is a hindrance, if you will, very outdated. It is the only power in the world that is for life. All the other powers are submitted, at least, to the institutions of the state. Elections, revalidation processes, etc. We hoped, then, that the Magistrates' Council would have a strictly popular representation, that on top of being a judicial power, one could enter through merit three exams, and not because you are a relative or friend of a judge, or the secretary, or the prosecutor in charge. And it was voted upon because it was sent as a project of the executive power. It was handled by both chambers with majority as is required, and absolute majority because to modify the Magistrates' Council, the Constitution demands an absolute majority. That is to say, half plus one of each of the members of Parliament. And regardless, they rejected it. It was the only time the court used its per saltum power to defend themselves as a corporatist sector. And look now, we have problems of the utility rates. Nobody knows what is going to have to be paid. Today, I read that it's possible the bills will have to be paid every 20 days. There's a headline in the newspaper that says that the bills will come every 20 days. And I say, are they also going to pay their salaries every 20 days? Because the bills are piling up. We don't know when they're going to end because of the issue with the law. None of that led to a per saltum, not even in the gravest moments we have lived. But in that case, it was used. And so, it is evident that there is a judicial game, that there is a judicial persecution, seems to be more than evident. That on top of this, it was actually announced. If you read the journalistic features, I would say during my last term in office in its totality, journalists, columnists, editorials would say during the last 4 years when I was in power that I was going to have serious problems with the law. It is written in bold letters. Or they were clairvoyant and they evidently formed part of a media judicial articulation that is now being unleashed. Allegations that I already faced as a president. I faced allegations 4 times for not being a lawyer and the degree they ended up giving me in Commodore Pi. Because 4 times they complained, saying that my degree as a lawyer was fake, and not now during my administration. They investigated me for illicit enrichment from 1995 to 2012. 3 cases, acquittals, and they continue. The case of the dollar futures, well, the case of the dollar futures is the most emblematic in terms of judicial persecution. Because what happened, I think that the magistrate, the person who initiated the case, when they summoned me and the Minister of the Economy, we were not summoned by the prosecutors. The magistrate thought that the beneficiaries of the contracts of the dollar futures were going to be friends of ours or people we knew. And it turns out, when they investigated, those who had been the beneficiaries of the contracts were the same ones who had done the devaluation. And it wasn't the same ones who had done the devaluation, but instead, in the case of one of the officials, the vice chief of the head of the cabinet was the one who had made a deal with the head of ROFEX, which is one of the futures markets, the price of what he was going to charge as a business person when he signed a contract of dollar futures, before they knew they were going to win the elections. He signed his contract and he fixed the price being an official. That is indeed a crime. That is a crime because it is incompatible negotiation with a conflict of interest. But no, they are not prosecuted. Those who devalued, nor those who charged the contracts of the dollar futures. Instead, we are the ones prosecuted. Those who tried to take care of the value of the currency, which we maintained. Because we knew that devaluation was going to have a brutal impact, like the one it had. Well, the truth is that it is an absolutely arbitrary case without any standing, which reveals the case of persecution. And finally, to embargo the pension of the president, which is pathetic and almost ridiculous. But well, this reveals a little bit of the situation of persecution. But well, I don't complain when you decide that those responsible for the genocide should be judged by the judges of the Constitution and receive the sentences for what they did. When you decide to recover buildings like the ESMA in order to turn them over to the memory, not just of the people, but of the world, when you decide to recover the administration of the resources of the workers who had received commissions to bribe private businessmen for $12 billion, when you decide that workers have to have a salary that permits them to live with dignity and to move the economy, when you decide you need to recover the state oil company, the most important company of Argentina and one of the top 2,000 most important companies in the world, when you decide to recover Argentine Airlines and transform it into a competitive airline, when you decide to recover AYSA, the old Obras Sanitarias, in order to make infrastructure projects that are needed, when you decide these things, well, it is clear that one of the risks you run is going to jail and that they will persecute you politically.
políticamente, cualquiera.
Anyone else would not have that risk, but they are risks that should be taken. Beyond the fact that any of those cases are all inventions and don't have the capacity to condemn anyone. But anyway, these are not legal risks, because there aren't any legal risks in applying the Constitution, the procedure codes, and fundamental codes. There should be no risk. Applying these codes in politics in Argentina, and yes, in the history of Argentina as well.
At one of the last meetings of Mercosur, you were very happy for the inauguration of Venezuela and also the incorporation of Bolivia. Now, we see a crisis in Mercosur and an intent to isolate Venezuela through the interim government of Brazil with the support of Paraguay and Argentina. The economist Alfredo Serrano Mancilla has an expression with respect to what's coming in the continent of our Latin America, which is a continent in contention. I remember when you signaled at the United Nations in 2009 what was happening in Honduras, that you put yourself forward to try and recover the government of Manuel Zelaya. There were various efforts at coup d'etats against Hugo Chavez in 2002, Rafael Correa, Fernando Lugo, and Evo Morales. How do you understand what's happening in the region, taking into consideration also what's happening in Brazil? What is the axis of the contention that makes it so that this conflict is so powerful?
It's very simple, Pedro. Today I was going to talk about it after the first question that Edgardo made. But you make it more punctually. You say continent in contention. And I think that is where the problem begins. I go back to when I was making an analysis that the United States was a bit distracted as a result of its fight against terrorism and that it had been strongly attacked in its own territory, in the case of the Twin Towers. I think that this continent in contention begins to be seen clearly when the national and popular governments of Brazil, Argentina, Venezuela, and Bolivia begin to have commercial, political, and economic relations with other international actors, fundamentally the People's Republic of China, fundamentally as well Russia, which were countries off limits to countries in the region. The strategic agreements that Argentina signed, for example, the first, which President Kirchner signed with President Hu Jintao, and I later deepened with President Xi Jinping, whose most demonstrable expression is the construction, for the first time, of two high-magnitude hydroelectric dams by the Chinese, nothing more and nothing less than in South America, the Belgrano Cargas. And I read today, fortunately, that talks had concluded with the Chinese government so that Belgrano Cargas, which transported over 9,000 kilometers and has a trajectory of 1,000 kilometers, crosses through the Neo-Noa portion of the country. I think it began there, and the participation of Brazil in BRICS. That meeting that I talked about where President Xi Jinping, Vladimir Putin, the South African president, were present. Call this evident, and Brasilia and the creation of that fund that could almost be seen as an alternative to the International Monetary Fund creates a red alert, I believe, in a country like the United States, which is a country that is not thinking about who's going to win the elections, if Hillary or Trump. In the North American system, it doesn't matter if one or the other wins. I'm not criticizing that they think that way as a power. All powerful countries think not in terms of the next presidential election or problem every election, but instead in a survival as such for the next 50 or 60 years, planning this way. The Communist Party of China also does it this way. China might even worry about it more because there are 1.5 billion people that need to be taken care of, and they're growing every day. Which is to say, the large, powerful countries have a strategic plan over the long term, and obviously, I believe the United States could have seen in the region that the People's Republic of China was entering. The Russian Federation was entering. And this could be an issue of contention in a region that is one of the most important aquifers of the world, one of the largest mineral reserves of the world, has one of the most important energy reserves in the world, Venezuela, our own Vaca Muerta. and food provision, also another fundamental thing. We are a large producer of food and raw materials for the world, with which we are a strategic region for development and maintenance of any powerful country today in the world. I think that this must have woken up interests, thinking and actions in a way that would be a limit to the entrance or the opening of these countries, of our countries, to governments. It is obviously also an issue of commercial disputes, geopolitical disputes. A new geopolitical map is being redesigned in a complicated world, much more complicated than it appears, because this appears to be a tension between China or the United States over economic questions, or Russia. But it has a new ingredient, which is the rise of terrorism in the world, a very powerful ingredient, very new, which is absolutely postmodernist. The leaders of modernity were of individual leadership, no?
Pedro, que los liderazgos de la modernidad.
Mandela, Fidel Castro, Charles de Gaulle, Kennedy, Perón, Yasser Arafat, these were individuals.
Kennedy, un Perón, eran.
Realize that the only inkling of a leadership similar to that of modernity is that of Vladimir Putin. But afterwards, leadership is based in a systemic form in what is the United States. Look at what's happening in the United States. Something else I'd like to talk about here. In a short while in the United States, the first Tuesday in November, there will be elections, and there are two candidates that can win, Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. One has, they say, 57% to 58% rejection.
Trump or Hillary Clinton?
Hillary, they say, has 52% to 53% rejection, which is to say, more than half of the U.S. citizens do not like the two candidates in their country. And that's to say that they are not going to vote for the candidate that they like most, which is the normal thing to do, but instead are going to vote for the candidate that seems to be the lesser evil. This is really bad for politics, because it gives a brutal power to corporations. And what the U.S. establishment has always feared is that another Roosevelt not appear and that suddenly the table is rearranged. In the United States, presidential re-election was unlimited until Roosevelt won four elections. He was also a man who fought against the corporations and would say, "I have the key, and I don't think to give it to any corporation because it belongs to the people of the United States." I believe that in an election where Hillary Clinton or Trump is elected, it's going to be a very weak president in the face of corporate power. In the United States, it's not individual leadership, it's systemic. It's a system of power. You also have Chinese leadership, which, because of specific characteristics, is the leadership of the Communist Party of China. This is not a secret, which also elects leaders for a limited time. But the one who leads is the Communist Party in China. Then there's Putin, with a leadership that is of an individual character. And then the leadership that is emerging in postmodernity are of a religious nature. A very strong leadership is that of Pope Francis. And on the other hand, in the Islamic world, which does not recognize any specific figure, but there is leadership of a religious spiritual character, of postmodernity, which is not bad or good in itself, but puts forward different challenges. Take, for example, what happened in Nice. This is an issue that I already talked about, and it seems that certain people on the Security Council did not like it when I had to intervene in September 2014 in New York, but the year before they had asked us to support them in invading Syria, ousting Assad, and helping the freedom fighters. The following year, the freedom fighters had become ISIS and were enemies of humanity. This did not happen over a century. This happened in only a year. What this means is that there was a bad evaluation on the part of the country that is the most powerful in the world concerning what was the Arab Revolution, the Arab Spring, or however you want to call it. A bad evaluation of who were the freedom fighters that turned out to be ISIS. And I said it at the time, that the world was going to become an insecure place no matter the location. And the terrorism that it sought was just that, to create terror. Those movies where they filmed people being beheaded in order to scare them was precisely the leitmotif of terrorism. And look what happened in Nice now. Any person who is scared of a terrorist attack would say, well, I won't take the subway because what happened in Atocha could happen. I'm not going to any busy restaurant because it could explode. If I see someone with a gun, I'm going to run because he could shoot me. It is no longer fear that someone will explode themselves or begin to shoot in the Istanbul airport. But we also saw in the last attack in Istanbul, where a large quantity of people died, what we could call known terrorism, classical terrorism. No, now we will find our lone wills. Who would think that when they see a truck, that that truck is going to run over them? No one. That's why there are so many deaths, because no one began to run away when they saw the truck coming, because nobody thinks that the truck is going to run them over. They think that if there's a terrorist, he's going to explode, or going to show up with a gun, or he's going to make a bomb explode, or they won't board a plane for fear that there will be an attack. This is terrorism, to make people feel they are not going to be safe in any place, in any part. The other day, I read two analyses. One runs from Jorge Alemán, a psychiatrist, who talked about terrorism and circular thought, about people who are lone wolves, who are not even organized, but instead see the words of their ancestors, and they go and wipe out everything. And that person, as well, suffers from inequality and marginalization in the economy, or in Western countries. One day, they get in their heads and they begin to try to cut people with a sword, as what happens on a plane. So we are living in a very complex world where there's not a clear strategy to confront the stairs and phenomenon as we saw in Nice, a far-right French city. Terrorism manifests itself this way. And so I believe that this requires from those who have immense responsibility of guiding the destiny of the world, because they do it, because they form part of the group of 5+1, that, for example, reached an agreement about Iran's nuclear capacity. They are the most important countries in the world. We can like it or not, they deserve our criticisms. But anyway, I think there is a leadership missing, sitting down to think of a different strategy. Because if they continue with the strategy of going and invading and bombing countries, every day we're going to be worse. Einstein used to say that a symptom of insanity was to think that with the same methods you would achieve different results. We have been doing this. They invade a country, they bomb, they kill the tyrant, the leader in charge. Look at what Libya is today. A conglomerate of tribes where you have to go and negotiate with every tribe to see if they can extract oil from here or there. I got to see Muammar Gaddafi sit down with all the African chiefs, all the heads of the tribes, and have them organized. What's more, when I was in Libya, Bush was in power. In that moment, he was president. And Gaddafi's oldest son was meeting with Condoleezza Rice in Washington, which is to say that there were negotiations. That is why I say there is a bad reading and a bad evaluation, and a product of that bad reading about evaluation is the errors made that allowed one of the most well-known diplomats in terms of the Middle East, Christopher Stevens, to be assassinated precisely in Benghazi, where the freedom fighters were. Well, where were the freedom fighters? They killed a U.S. diplomat who is an expert on Middle East affairs. And so I think it is time to sit down and rethink strategies. I don't know the answer, you don't know the answer, but I imagine that those who sit down or will sit down in Washington, in the Kremlin, in Beijing, in Berlin, in Paris or in London, they're going to have to do it. They're going to have to do it because this is getting worse. And that's not even dealing with the economic question, which I believe is another issue that is tied to this. Rogers said it the other day, that the issue of inequality is also a generator of the lone wolves in the world, in Europe. This man that was driving the truck was a Frenchman, son of Tunisians. He killed a ton of Muslim people and Tunisians, running them over with the truck. Look how this is becoming an uncontrollable snowball. This is why I say it is a very complex world and requires a lot of intelligence, and fundamentally understanding that the path is serious international cooperation, that the world of domination, where one would say this and everyone would say yes, has ended. At least for one part of the world, it's over. To that man who got on the truck, he was not interested in what the President of the United States had to say, nor what Putin had to say, nor what Xi Jinping had to say. And the next guy who gets on who knows what and crashes into who knows who also isn't going to care. And so it seems to me that this is where we need to be. There is a social communication phenomenon in this world that is totally connected, where I hit enter and I find out that someone is filming a killing. What is happening in the United States, we have a president of color and racial conflict is reborn, with police killed by people of color who feel aggrieved by the police. It is not a secret that the prison population of the United States, the biggest in the world, is made up fundamentally of people of color and Latinos. And so inequality is also a powerful element at a time in a world that is so insecure. I'm not saying it's the only condiment. I think there are many more, and we need to sit down and think about them.
President, returning a little to Argentina. The government took a series of decisions that in his time were criticized by certain sectors of society, such as the exchange rate regime or the import regime. From the point of view today, would you take the same decisions or would something change? Thank you.
With the exchange rate machine, there was great fusion. I knew this question was coming, so I was looking at some numbers. Between January 27, 2014, and December 4th, 2015, a little bit less than 2 years, do you know how many dollars were sold in the single free exchange market that the central bank sold not to importers, not entrepreneurs, but to those who bought bills with the consent of the AFIP to Treasure? $9.5 billion in bills to keep. Regardless, they would say that people could not buy dollars. And one would go and look at the quantity, those who are purchasing. I didn't have the names, but I did have information about business segments. It was wage earners. But on top of that, it was very easy to prove it. The largest purchase of dollars always took place between the 28th and 29th of every month, on the 4th and 5th of the following month, which is when wages would be paid. That is to say, there were Argentines from the salaried sector that were able to buy $10 billion, despite the fact that the newspapers would say they don't sell dollars. And I'm not even touching on the Argentines who traveled throughout the world with credit cards. And there it was unlimited. The card had to be paid, and the government paid the cards and the travel. And so they created this idea and society that you could not access dollars. When Kirchner arrived to power, you could access some $500,000 per person per month. Of course, no one could buy them in that moment, or very few could buy them. Later, when the economy was growing, this was increased to $200 million per month in order to avoid the overvaluation of the peso. But in all reindustrialization processes, but the one Argentina had, the strangulation of the external sector, and in processes of large upward social mobility, where there is also a very ingrained custom in Argentine society to hoard dollars for savings, which does not happen, for example, in Brazil or in other economies. Strangulation of the external sector via demand for dollars in hard currency has been a constant in our history. This happened to Perón as well during his first and second governments. That's because it's a product of economic growth and an acceleration in growth. Because, it's funny, some say that we were an anti-US government. If you look at the balance of payments during a pro-US government, like the one under Menem during the 1990s, the commercial balance of payments was a deficit for the United States. Regardless, the commercial balance during our government was absolutely a surplus for the United States, because we were reindustrializing ourselves and buying capital goods for industry to produce, and the rest, we necessarily demanded more technology from other economies, and the United States was one of those. That being said, I would not change the exchange rate policy. What I would change, maybe, would be industrial policies to make it less dependent, or that development be more perfect, and that the productive chain not require much foreign exchange. Notice this one thing. There was a protest around November 8th because people could not buy dollars. And I asked all those people, how many dollars can you buy? The myth was created that there were none, which is why I reiterate how many Argentines can buy as many dollars as before. Surely there are some, and it's not bad that there are some, because there were always some. What's wrong is to deceive and to lie to people. This is what I was saying. A hegemonic media apparatus creates a common sense, in the Gramscian sense. And it ultimately ends up operating against the interests of those of us who use that common sense. I realize it's because they were people who criticized the subsidies and now go out to protest because they can't afford gas, and it's good that they do it. Because there is also another myth I want to clarify, as it is also important. It was said that there was a gap between what is charged in services to Greater Buenos Aires and deep inside the country. I want, in this solemn act, to tell how the system worked. The company that sold power is CAMMESA, through the state. It is the administrator, in charge of the tasks that are divided into generation, transmission, and distribution. Our government charged the same per megawatt to denounced and teleSUR, the big distributors in the capital and Greater Buenos Aires, as to APEC, the distributor in Cordoba, as to the one in Santa Fe, Misiones, or Santa Cruz. What did they do here? The province's distribution company is public. But the ones who charged per megawatt much more expensively were the distributors, which, in some cases, are of the state, and in other cases, private. This didn't happen in Buenos Aires, because denounced and teleSUR are the only two companies in which the price is regulated by the state. The same state, represented today by the current government, has made an immense transfer to the distributors, in which there are also friends of the government. Petrobras, which was bought in an operation of Pampa Energy, a fund administered by Midland and Lewis, magnate of the South, an operation done with $900 million, of which $300 million was paid. $600 million remains to be paid to Petrobras. And who is going to pay this difference? Midland? No. All of the gas consumers of the Republic of Argentina are going to pay for it. That's why we should look at how the corporate staff of the main generators and distributors of electricity and gas are made up. Without going any further, who was the head of Metrogas until December of last year, and is today in charge of Energas, which has to be held to control Metrogas? So, another problem regarding tariff matters is collusion, the conflict of interest between those who are the owners of oil and gas companies and government officials. And then there's the case of the head of the Ministry of Energy, who in our government would have been the subject of complaints in The Hague or in the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. The other thing you asked was with respect to imports.
Importaciones, otro gran tema.
Today we have a system of free imports, and we can see gondolas with products from around the world. This free trade is no longer practiced in any part of the world. It is a banner brandished by the central countries while we, for example, are forbidden entry of lemons into the United States. And we had to sue so that they would let our beef in. Everyone looks after their production. They're business people, they're traders, which doesn't mean that we close ourselves off from the world. In fact, what we wanted is for the multinationals to come and invest. Now, if they are allowed to freely import, why am I going to come to invest in the country with a depressed internal consumption market if I can produce at a lower cost in my country of origin? So I'm going to open a commercial import office with a chain of distributors, period. The problem is that this is short-term, as once there's no consumption and the shops have closed, who's going to buy these imported products? There will be a few, but that is not good for democracy or for the country. These policies should be reviewed. It's not closing off the economy. It means taking care of what is produced. Now, one can find oranges from Israel or pigs from Denmark. You know, the number of people who didn't even vote for us, who invested in rural sectors, in pig farms, because it was necessary to cover the domestic market share. And today, they must want to kill them because pigs are brought in from Brazil or Germany at prices they can't compete with, which, along with cutting export taxes on corn, a basic import for poultry, pork, and dairy, triggers an international value. The dairy sector is also in bad shape. Corn is expensive. Veterinary products increase much more than the price of their product, just like the basic inputs for the farm. The exchange rate is set back. In addition, there is no domestic consumption to withstand an exchange rate that would be competitive for national production. This is the big issue. The difficulties that I see in broad strokes, that the best team of the last 50 years is sure to find a solution to. For now, we must demand that they find a solution to something so simple like gas prices, because people no longer know how much nor when they have to pay. 400%, 1,000%, every 2 months, every 20 days. Anyway, if they can find a solution to this, then they can find a solution to much more complex things.
Presidenta, en los últimos meses hemos visto.
In recent months, we have seen people close to you appear in court. Are you concerned about the possibility of warrant for your arrest? And what is your response to the number of generalizations we see in the media?
Sobre usted.
Bueno. In principle, with respect for fear of jail, no. If I had been afraid, I would not have done the things that I did in government. Possibly, I would not have fought in the political spaces I fought, and since I was very young, either. To be peronist was never easy in this country, and it was never free.
Desde muy joven, o sea, ser peronista en este país nunca fue fácil. Nunca fue fácil ser peronista, y nunca fue gratis ser peronista.
Peronist, with the guidance we have always had, those of us who share this space. In terms of the episodes that you mentioned, no generalization is good. What could have happened with this ex-official, and without minimizing it, has to do with what can happen with any government. But I also want to say that hearing someone that has the last name Macri talk about looking at the state, talk about public works or certain things, seems to me a lack of respect for Argentines' memory and recent history. I don't have a single construction company. In fact, I said it the other day, speaking with your colleague. I argue that it is necessary to create in the parliament a bicameral commission to audit public works. In Argentina, $107 billion were invested in public works in the last 12 years. In an earlier period, from 1990 to 2002, $18 billion were invested. All I ask is that an audit be conducted on the last 12 years to determine whether there were overcharges and who kept them. Because at this time that the government decreed the resetting of prices for public works is essential. In which works was it reset, and in which was there overpricing? The last $45 billion were decreed for the underground of the Sarmiento train, a work that we could never start because UTE, the company that won the tender, was part of IECSA, of Calcatera, Macri's cousin, together with Odebrecht and other companies, which required private financing. It couldn't be from the state. But now I come to find out that by decree they assigned $45 billion to finance it. What happened with the companies that lost that bid because they didn't have external financing? That's why I believe that there must be an audit of public works in the last 12 years, since there's $107 billion, of which 57% was executed by the national government. But the rest was executed and tendered by provincial and municipal governments. The only thing that the national government did was send the money. You have $25 billion in roads, the same among energy infrastructure, $15 billion in housing, executed by the provinces, and $12 billion in waterworks. Another $11 billion in transfers from federal support funds of soy, executed in the municipal governments. That's why it would be very interesting and necessary to determine what happened, and each one must answer for what they did. I live in this house, which is in my name, and it is mine since before the presidency. I do not live in a house done by any builder. I believe that the issue of generalization is not good. And furthermore, with the conflicts of interest and some cases of public, notorious, and scandalous knowledge, And for the prosecutors, it is simple. Enough with picking up the phone to know with whom those officials talked, with whom they met. We see that some of the main bidders are also members of the government. We have to be careful with that because it ends up fully impacting policies. As if politics implies that all are equal, which is synonymous with corruption. And when this ends up taking root in society, it is a triumph of corporations that continue managing people through the concept that politics is corrupt. No, politics is not corrupt. There can be corrupt politicians, so identify them. As for the question about the lawsuits, I think that even the most anti-K journalists, if you want to call them that, say that the dollar futures lawsuit is arbitrary. How can they process a president, an economy minister, and the director of the central bank that were not those who decided on devaluation, nor were the beneficiaries of the dollar futures contract? There you have a first case that is clearly stigmatization of a political sector. But in addition to the complaints that they have made against me, including while being president, I have been acquitted in three cases of illicit enrichment. They investigated me from the year 1995 almost until the year 2012, always with things connected to affidavits. They didn't find I had a single account in Panama. I do not have any offshore account. I don't have secret companies they discovered about me. Everything they say is written in my own affidavits, signed and presented by me, not only before the Anti-Corruption Office, but also before the AFIP. Could someone be so stupid to declare things in an affidavit so that later, based on the numbers that are in the affidavit, they say no, they committed a crime? And it turns out that every day there are people that, when they don't have accounts in HSBC, fled their money from the country, that appeared in the Panama Papers, later say that they have forgotten that they had an account. Can anyone imagine if they found I had an offshore account and I say I did not realize that I had an offshore account? Would they have accepted me if I said that? When the Panama Papers came out, this was said by the German journalists themselves, the Argentine journalists were excited because they thought they were going to find a Kirchner in the Panama Papers. And they didn't find a single Kirchner. And they're not going to find, not at least Nestor Kirchner, Cristina Kirchner, Maximo Kirchner, and Florencia Kirchner. Because all we have had, we have in the country. I haven't told you about when they invented about my son an account with Nil de Gare of $40 million on the cover of Clarín. Do you know the number of people around here who see this newspaper cover and then aren't even aware when Maximo speaks on the radio to refute it and stick with the Clarín cover saying that Maximo had $40 million? Or what happened yesterday? Or the day before yesterday, with Milagro Sala's famous car. I can show you an entire 4 pages of internet sites from around the country saying a BMW full of money belonging to Milagro Sala was found. Then the news came out that it wasn't true. Do you know the number of people that read those 4 pages saying that, and they did not read that there was no money of Milagro Sala? Just yesterday, I went onto one of the sites of the embassy, and I see ex-Senator K detained in Aziza with $30,000. Everyone is K. It turns out that this ex-senator was not elected in 2011 because I proposed that the current vice governor of the province, Dr. Pablo González, be the one who stood as a candidate for senator in the province of Santa Cruz. However, the news put that this former senator with the $30,000 was K. They know one thing. The brother of this ex-senator, who's an accountant, better not to say the name, we don't need to dirty people's names, we need to wait for what justice determines. The brother of this ex-senator, who was also one of our officials in BIC, is now collaborating with the Ministry of Economy in Prat Gray, together with the Secretary of the Treasury. Through this ex-senator, I met Dr. Lorenzetti, who is a close friend. He was the one who introduced me to him when I was a senator. He even told me that he was an excellent candidate to be a member of the court. Or another example that happened with another ex-senator who I met and who was a colleague of mine from the Radical Civic Union, or UCR. He brought a person from Paraguay linked to ephedrine trafficking, telling and threatening the Minister of Security and government officials to fear because he was going to talk. It's now said that this ex-senator, ex-president of the UCR, president of the legislators, and architect of the alliance between UCR and Cambiemos, this man was denounced for having received a bribe of $200,000 to accuse the ephedrine judge and get rid of him. But as he's from the radical party, it's a lie. How's it so? If those who are accused are Peronists, they are repentant. If the one accused is someone from Cambiemos or a radical, they are condemned. I think we have to start to measure everyone with the same yardstick and put an end to this and each one of the explanations that has to be given. But this also requires justice that acts within the law. This is another problem we have, for it to respect constitutional guarantees, because we have fought a lot for that. And what I also see in this stage, and something that concerns me very much, is that there is this kind of very noticeable decrease in the intensity of the rule of law. The rule of law has always been an obstacle to imposing plans of misery, hunger, and transfer of resources from salaried sectors, middle classes, and small and medium-sized businesses to the most concentrated sectors. It was always necessary to have a military coup in order to be able to do these kinds of plans. Today, through the media and the judicial district, this is no longer necessary. It is therefore very important that judicial processes be in accordance with the guarantees established in the Constitution, that they be in accordance with the fundamental codes and codes of practice. We can't be making accusations or putting on shows or media spectacles based on a violation of the guarantees that every citizen has, whether they've been a president or a street sweeper. Being president doesn't give you more rights than any other citizen, but it doesn't give you less rights either. And I think that is the issue. And when one sees, as we saw yesterday with those sites about the BMW, I wonder how many people will read later that this was a lie? And how many people will know that this senator who was found with $30,000 is not a ex-senator? How many people will know that it was a lie that Maximo had $40 million in the Bahamas? How many people will know that it was a lie that Florencia had an apartment on Park Avenue in the heart of Manhattan? How many people will know that it was a lie that I did a renovation worth 28 million pesos for my daughter when she was pregnant in the city of Olivos? And how many people will know that my daughter doesn't have and didn't have at 17 years old a Mini Cooper for the simple reason that she doesn't know how to drive? The last time my son left the country was in 2001. The son of two ex-presidents. The last time Máximo Kirchner left the country was in the year 2001. I challenge any other Argentine politician, because Máximo is also involved in politics, to tell me if their children don't leave the country for a trip abroad. And it's not bad that they do it. Neither is it an epic task that Máximo hasn't gone abroad. But we also have to see how each one of us lives in order to be able to evaluate and judge. I think that this is also important. Or in the case of my daughter, who doesn't live in Park Avenue, New York. She lives in an apartment in Monserrate and doesn't have a car because she doesn't know how to drive. These are the things that also have to be taken into account. And I reiterate, this is my house, the one that I had before being president, and it is not from any construction company, and much less a construction company that is a partner, as well as a friend, of the power today that has done works in the state. That's why I say that what the judge has to do is look at the loads of telephone calls to see who everyone is connected with. It's not so difficult. And this also means that on the part of the political leader, that there not be opportunism of believing that from trumped-up allegations, they are going to achieve a better position. History shows that this is not so, that it lasts very little. I don't know anyone who has passed into history or who has managed to convince the big national majorities of a project for the country or for the patria through these things. They should rethink it and try if, upon winning a popular consensus defending the interests of the people today feeling attacked, and watch.
ganarse el consenso popular defendiendo los intereses.
They are the people that are K, or anti-K, because the K and anti-K have to pay the gas bill, the electricity and water bill that is also not talked much about, and that suffered a shocking increase. The K and anti-K, and those who aren't anything, also have to pay it. And the shopping cart you get at the supermarket. I can assure you that the Port Salut cheese that cost 100 pesos for half a kilo in La Anonima 1 month ago now costs nearly 300. And the radicals, the Peronists, and everyone who wants to buy half a kilo of Port Salut de la Serenissima in La Anonima of the Brown family here in the city of Calafate all have to pay for it.